إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters in Islam, ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها. By the soul, by the nafs, and the one who fashioned it and made it subject to wickedness and subject to righteousness. Indeed, successful are those who purify that nafs, and indeed losers are those who neglect their nafs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters, in the Quran also said, إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبِّي إِنَّ رَبِّي غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Indeed, the nafs, the soul, is inclined to evil, except those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows His mercy upon. Brothers and sisters in Islam, an enemy that a lot of us are not aware of resides inside our bodies, which is our nafs, our soul. A lot of us are unaware of that enemy to start with. Secondly, a lot of us are not treating their nafs as enemies. And here is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, the best, who accomplished ubudiyyah, servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In every lecture, he would start by saying, وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ أَنفُسِنَا. And we seek refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evil of our nafs, of our soul. When Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu asked him words, asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to teach him words that can he say in the morning, and words that can he say at the sunset, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught him a beautiful dua. and the hadith in Sunan al-Tirmidhi. In the hadith, وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّ نَفْسِي اللهم عالم الغيب والشهادة فاطر السماوات والأرض رب كل شيء ومليك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أعوذ بك من الشيطان وشركه وأعوذ بك من شر نفسي. A dua that you say every morning. O Allah, I seek refuge with you from the evil that resides inside me. When Husayn ibn Ubayd radiyallahu anhu, the father of Imran, came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the hadith is sahih in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, he was a kafir then. He was not a Muslim yet. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, Ya Husayn, kam ta'budu min ilah? O Husayn, how many gods do you worship? قَالَ أَعْبُدُ سَبْعَةً. I worship seven gods. Six in earth and one in the heaven. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a method, beautiful method of da'wah, سأله, asked him, وَأَيُّ إِلَهٍ تَدْعُوا لِرَغَبِكَ وَرَهَبِكَ. When you go through hardship, which of these ilah do you seek? قال الذي في السماء. He said, I always call once I'm in trouble the one in the سماء. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Aslim, become a Muslim. I'll teach you good words that you can invoke that God in the سماء. فأسلم. He became a Muslim. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, say, Allahumma alhimni rushdi waqini sharra nafsi. O Allah, give me my light and safeguard me from the evil of my nafs. Brothers and sisters in Islam, this is a very important subject to you, for you to understand. That you have an enemy out there inside you, that resides inside you, which is your nafs, your own soul, that you have to wage war, you have to battle. How many times we hear people coming to you, telling you, I've been involved too much in sinning, and I've been trying to stop. I've been trying, but it's not working. You know why? The nafs. How many of the brothers we see in the masjid for a week, and by all of a sudden they disappear for a year, and then they reappear again for a week? It's their nafs. How many times have you been trying, my brothers and sisters in Islam, to keep up with your five daily prayers? And you're failing until now. Lack of jihad against your nafs. Lack of struggle against your soul, against your nafs to do so. How many of us who say, I used to do this sin and I repented and I made a promise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I will never go back to it. And I tried, I succeeded for a week, but then I came back to it. I ended up committing that sin again. Brothers and sisters in Islam, it's the nafs. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never change your condition. As an individual, he will not change the condition of the ummah as an ummah until we change from within. The first arena of jihad, brothers and sisters in Islam, is your nafs. There is a statement out there that they attribute to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They say that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned from the battle of Tabuk. He said, that's what they say, he said, we came back from the minor jihad to the major jihad, or the greater jihad, or the mightier jihad. عُدْنَا مِنَ الْجِهَادِ الْأَصْغَرِ إِلَى الْجِهَادِ الْأَكْبَرِ. قَالُوا وَمَا الْجِهَادُ الْأَكْبَرُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. They ask him, what is the mightier or the greater jihad, O Messenger of Allah? قَالَ جِهَادُ النَّفْسِ. He said, the jihad that you wage against your own nafs. Number one, this hadith is fabricated. It's incorrect to attribute that statement to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the meaning of that statement is rooted in the text. I mean by the text, the Quran and the Sunnah. Sometimes there is a beautiful statement out there that matches the Quran and the Sunnah, but you attributing it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the wrong thing. And here why they attribute it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we're not going to take long in this because we want to go back to the nafs. Those who speak this hadith, their intention is to erase the jihad against the disbelievers from the map of Islam. That you can jihad, you see, they make that statement in order to confine the term jihad only against yourself. The jihad against the disbelievers, the kafirs, no. And this is untrue. Wallah, if you jump up and down, you cannot do this. وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا. Fight those who fight you in the cause of Allah. It's in the Quran. So, without going there, that's the intention of those who promote that statement. What they want is, they want to confine the jihad into the jihad of the nafs. And al-kuffar just leave it. It's not in the religion. لا يقول هذا إلا زنديق. But the meaning, the spirit of the text is there. Why? If you place a comparison between jihadun nafs, the jihad that you wage against your nafs, and the jihad that you wage against the disbelievers, you will find out the jihad against your nafs is obligatory upon every Muslim. This is what the fuqaha say, fardu aynin. Everyone must wage a war, a jihad against himself. But jihadul kuffar, the jihad against the disbeliever, fardu kifaya, a communal. Meaning, if some of the Muslims do it, then it is not mandatory upon the rest. Secondly, that makes the jihad against the nafs greater than the jihad against the disbelievers. Secondly, whether you win or lose in your jihad against the disbelievers, you end up with a great reward. Anyways, فَلْيُقَاتِلْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يَشْرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا بِالْآخِرَةِ وَمَنْ يُقَاتِلْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَيُقْتَلْ أَوْ يَغْلِبْ فَسَوْفَ نُؤْتِيهِ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. قُلْ هَلْ تَرَبَّصُونَ بِنَا إِلَّا إِحْدَى الْحُسْنَيَيْنِ. So, in both cases, you're a winner. Just going out there, if you lose the battle, you're a winner. If you win, you're a winner. Meaning, in regard to a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But once it comes to the jihad that you wage against your nafs, you must win it. If you lose it, the jihad that you wage against your nafs, if you lose that jihad, two things are going to happen. As-sagharu fi dunya wa an-naru fi al-akhirah. Humiliation in this world, if you fail to wage war against yourself, and if you fail to win that war, that battle against your own nafs, with the help of course and the support of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will mean two things. Humiliation in the dunya, Look, two hadith that explain one another. Hadith Thawban fi Abi Dawood, wa hadith Abdullah ibn Umar with Abi Dawood as well. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once he talked about the state of the ummah, that all the nations will gather against them. Why, O Messenger of Allah? Because of al-wahan, weakness. What is al-weakness, O Messenger of Allah? حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا وَكَرَاهِيَةُ الْمَوْتِ. And the nafs desires the dunya. The nafs desires the dunya, desires the quick passing. The nafs wants its pleasure now, now. So, إِذَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ بِالْعِينَ وَأَخَذْتُمْ أَذْنَابَ الْبَقَرِ وَرَضِيْتُمْ بِالزَّرْحِ وَتَرَكْتُمُ الْجِهَادِ صَلَّطَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ذُلًّا. Basically, if you fail to wage war against your nafs, to take it to the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to take it from the haram to the halal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inflict you with humiliation. So, if you fail that battle, that war against your nafs, that means you're going to be humiliated in the dunya. Sunnah, akhi. Wallah. Wallah, sunnah. Sunnah min sunanillah. One of the ways of Allah. If you do not make yourself a slave to Allah, people will enslave you. Everyone around you will enslave you. If you don't make Allah your Lord, everyone else is going to be your Lord. That's sunnah. It's the way it is. Secondly, the hereafter, you lose it. فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا فَإِنَّ الْجَحِيمَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Whoever transgresses and prefers again this dunya, the hellfire is his final and everlasting abode. Look at the opposite. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. And whosoever fear the standing before his Lord and tell his nafs, no, no, my nafs, come, let's do what is right, my nafs, the Jannah is his everlasting abode. So the spirit of the text is there, but to use the text to send the message there is not going to work, because it's in the deen. Brothers and sisters in Islam, النفس جبل في طريقك إلى ربك. All of us are traveling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of us. You know what? Your nafs is a mountain in the road. You must climb that mountain. You have no other choice. You cannot go around it. There is no valleys. It's a mountain, huge mountain that you have to climb. You have to climb. You have to do something called tazkiyah. Tazkiyatun nafs. Inshallah, in 10 minutes, if you give me your attention, we're going to understand together what is tazkiyatun nafs. What do we mean by that? What does it mean that you have to? Because in the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Successful indeed the one who will purify his nafs. Now what does it mean to purify your nafs? The word tazkiyah in Arabic means to clean and beautify. At-takhliyah wa-tahliyah. That you remove something out of the way and you place something in its place. Because if you leave it empty, something else is going to come and take over. So what you're supposed to do with your nafs is to remove things, two things, and to replace it with two things. Remove what? Number one, traits that we are all were fashioned with. Traits, I mean attributes of the nafs. Things that we were born with. And I'll explain. Two, sins that you became so accustomed to that you cannot give it up. Each one of us has a sin
Each one of us, everyone, I'm telling you, everyone has a sin that your nafs demands. Certain sins or a sin, could be one, could two, three, four. So you have to remove that. Let's talk about the first, which the traits. If you go through the Quran, any time that you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about al-insan, وَحَمَلَهَا الْإِنسَانُ إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. And al-insan, mankind bore the amana, indeed he was ignorant, he was unjust. So our nafs, my nafs and your nafs, were born ignorant. وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought you out of the wombs of your mothers, don't know anything. Then He equipped you with the means with which you could learn. وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ السَّمْعَ. He given you hearing, so you could hear a teacher, a lecture. وَالْأَبْصَارَ, so you could read, recite. وَالْأَفْئِدَ, and the hearts, so you could reflect upon what you're learning. So, by nature, akhi, all of us were born ignorant. Now, you must replace that trait with knowledge. So, you're going to remove ignorance and place knowledge. What knowledge I'm talking about here? Akhi, the knowledge that circles around the answer to those three questions. Who is your Lord? What is your deen? And what do you say about the man who was sent to you? The three questions that all of us will be asked as soon as they place us in the graveyard and leave us alone. Alhamdulillah, if you've been excelling in medicine and engineering and IT, you've done so well with that brain. Good, but this is not the knowledge that we're talking about. If you have 5-10 PhDs in medicine, in whatever you call it, and again, please don't misunderstand me, I'm not a backward, go ahead. But I'm telling you, you are still ignorant in the area of the deen, with all due respect. Please excuse my language. I'm sorry for... You're still ignorant in this area. This is the jahl that you must remove. If you don't learn who's your Lord, what is your deen, the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, you're still ignorant in the side of zulm. By nature, by the way, we are all fashioned to be zalims, unjust, unfair. Now, you're supposed to replace this with adl, with justice. And that's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls upon me, upon you, hadith Abi Dar, and the Muslim, Sahih Muslim, Ya ibadi, my servants, inni harramtu al-zulma ala nafsi, wa ja'altuhu baynakum muharraman, fala tadhalamu fi riwayah, fala tadhalamu fi riwayah. Oh my slaves, I have made zulm, being unjust, haram on me. Allah is talking. It's haram on Allah to be unfair, to be unjust. And I also made it unfair, made it haram amongst you. So do not transgress against one another. فَلَا تَظَّالَمُ. So, if you're still unjust to yourself to start with, to your wife to start with, to your family to start with, to your neighbor to start with, to your Muslim brother you start with, you still have that trait that you're fashioned with, and you're supposed to replace it with adl, justice. You have to be fair. Fair. If you want to purify your nafs, continue being unfair, but you have not purified your nafs. قُلْ لَوْ أَنْتُمْ تَمْلِكُونَ خَزَائِنَ رَحْمَةِ رَبِّي إِذًا لَأَمْسَكْتُمْ خَشْيَةَ الْإِنْفَاقِ وَكَانَ الْإِنْسَانُ قَتُورًا. Again, الإنسان. Look at this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Surah Al-Isra. If you possess the keys of the treasures of Allah, you will withhold. You will not going to spend. And mankind was fashioned to be miser, stingy. If you are still stingy, that means you have not changed the trait yet. You still have it. What you're supposed to do is replace it with spending. That is why the text in the Quran, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ يَا إِلَّا likeness of those who spend their wealth like a seed. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْفِقُوا. Oh, who you believe, spend. يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ. Rasulullah s.a.w. says, يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ, O son of Adam, أُنْفِقْ, أُنْفِقْ, أُنْفِقْ عَلَيْكْ. Spend, I'll spend on you. So, if you're still withholding, that means you have not purified your nafs in this area. وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ أَكْثَرَ شَيْءٍ جَدَلًا. By trait, by the way, by the nature, you like to argue. By trait. This is a trait that you have. Now, you're supposed to stop arguing. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives you the beautiful incentive. Hadith Abi Umama radiallahu anhu fi sunan Abi Dawood. أَنَا زَعِيمٌ بِبَيْتٍ فِي رَبْضِ الْجَنَّةِ لِمَنْ تَرَكَ الْمِرَاءَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مُحِقَّا. Look at this. Incentive. Look at this. Incentive. If you leave off arguing, of course we're talking about arguing that aimless, just to satisfy your ego. That's what we're talking about. But if you argue with somebody, well, it should be called debate then. Well, if you leave arguing, you will have a house in paradise. And on and on. Arrogance, akhi. Pride. If you still have pride, that's a trait that you were born with. That's a trait that you were born with. That by nature, mankind is arrogant. We're arrogant. They tell you that every human being has a Pharaoh inside his heart, inside his head. The Pharaoh is somebody who said, I am your Lord. And you cannot go crazy more than that. Everyone has this. Now Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells you hadith Abdullah ibn Mas'ud fi Sahih Muslim, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال ذرة من كبر. The one who has the weight of an atom of pride and arrogance in his heart will not enter paradise. Abdullah ibn Salam, the first rabbi who ever became a Muslim, Jewish rabbi. One day they found him carrying loads on his back from the market and going home. So Abdullah ibn Salam, the companion of the Prophet, the predecessor, said, this is Abdullah ibn Salam. Why are you doing this, Abdullah? And he has servants. He has people who could serve him. You know what he said? I sense some arrogance from my soul and I wanted to put it down. لأني سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, because I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying that if you have the weight of an atom of pride in your heart, you will not enter paradise. So, and on and on, by the way, the list goes on. Liking to be ahead, for example, to be the boss, is also a trait. Liking to speak all the time, liking to get attention all the time. Like in a gathering, you like to be the head. It's all a trait that you must work on. مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. Whoever believes in Allah and the day of resurrection, let him speak what is good or be silent. So, الشاهد, the important thing is, you have to go back and stop and find out which of those do you have. And how can you change it? How can you take yourself from that jahiliyyah? And subhanAllah, don't be ashamed, akhi, of it. Yani, wallahi, I look into this hadith. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one day, Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, radiallahu anhu, told Bilal. Abu Dharr is a companion, told Bilal, Ya ibn al-Sawda, the son of the black. You know the Arabs, they had this thing going with the tribe, with the color. Bigotry. They call it bigotry. You know what Rasulullah told him? Ya Aba Dharr, innaka mru'un fika jahiliyya. You are a person who have jahiliyya in him. You still have not changed in that area. It still comes to you. See how Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu wanted to He placed his head in the ground. He placed his cheek to the ground and he said, Bilal, please come step on here. I'm sorry. I said, there is nothing wrong, Akhi. There is nothing wrong with you checking your own nafs and finding out what kind of trait that you have and how can you change it. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with al-Muhajirin and al-Ansar, in one occasion, when al-Ansar, al-Aws al-Khazraj, in another occasion, al-Muhajirin al-Ansar fi Bani al-Mustaliq, al-Aws al-Khazraj in Medina, went and started fighting. I am an Arab, you are this, you are that, I'm Ansari, you're Muhajir. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came out, Abi da'wa al-Jahiliyyati wa ana bayna adhhurikum. Are you going to go back to Jahiliyyah? So, Akhi, if you want to purify your nafs in this area, you must replace that trait and you must insert. You know, they tell you cut and paste. Cut and paste. Cut. The blameworthy traits, attributes, and paste the praiseworthy attributes. أبدل المذموم بالمحمود. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the second thing that you have to do, all of us are victims to a sin that we are so used to. And this is, in my opinion, the most difficult. Because if your heart already has sucked the love of this, it will be very difficult. You know, imagine a sponge, and you place ink on that sponge. The ink will go inside until it reaches right in the middle of that sponge. You could wash that sponge so many times, but you will still see ink there. The sin that you have been committed, your heart drank it. تعرض الفتن على القلوب كعرض الحصير عودا 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 فأيما قلب أشربها نكت فيه نكتة سوداء. You see, the sin that you liked, your heart drank it. You're in love with it. In order for you to clean that sponge, you have to keep washing it. Washing it again. Yes, I'm going to stop. I'm going to stop. You're going to flunk. Sorry to use the term. You have to wash it again. You have to try. Even if you repent 300 times every day from that sin, you have to keep washing that heart and try and try. And one time, bi-idhnillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you all tawfiq, one time you will be truthful in your repentance and Allah will take you out of it. But you have to try. You cannot say, I tried to stop smoking for too long and it just my blood drank it. He said, that's your nafs telling you that I've been drinking and I tried. Actually, I pray better while I'm drunk. Who said that? You cannot do that. No, you have to try. You see, your nafs is going to come to you and convince. No, there is nothing difficult with Allah. Nothing difficult with Allah. But you must try to come out of that sin. You must try. Secondly, the second thing that you have to do is to replace that sin with acts of obedience. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it a condition for the acceptance of your tawbah that you must combine that tawbah with amalin salih. Look at this. إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. Accept those. The verses talked about killing. The verses talked about adultery. The verses talked about zina. The verses talked about worshipping idols. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, accept those who repent and they believe and they do righteous deeds. إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Salah, if you keep up with it, it will take you away from الفحشاء and المنكر. يعني أحاديث, I'm going to mention it, but please don't misunderstand it. It's not a license for you to continue sinning. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told about someone who commits a sin, but he prays tahajjud at night. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, صَلَاتُهُ سَتَنْهَاهُ عَنِ الْفَاحِشَةِ ذَاتِ يَوْمِ. His salah at night, if he continues with it, will help him to stop one day that sin that he's committing. You have to engage, أخي, your nafs into the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Aslami, and the hadith in Sahih Muslim, used to be serving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one of the battles. Every night he would go and prepare for him his wudu, brings him the water, kind of taking care of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Sal ya Rabi'a, ask me Rabi'a, what do you want? I'm going to make a dua for you. What do you want? قال يا رسول الله أسألك مرافقتك في الجنة. I want to be your companion in Jannah. You see? You know what the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him to do? Ya Rabi'a, oh Rabi'a, a'inni. Listen careful to that statement. A'inni ala nafsika bikathrati sujood. Help me against your nafs with a lot of prostration. Sujood, salah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, يا أيها المزمل, سورة المزمل, go back and read it tonight. It commands the Muslims, سيدة عائشة رضي الله عنها, and the hadith الصحيح في مسند الإمام أحمد, that the Muslims were commanded for a whole year to pray tahajjud. صلاة التهجد, the salah at night was mandatory for 1 year. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the takhfif, made it voluntary in the last verse. إِنَّ رَبَّكَ يَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ تَخُومُ أَدْنَى مِنْ ثُلُثَيِ اللَّيْلِ وَنِصْفَهُ وَثُلُثَهُ وَطَائِفَةٌ مِنَ الَّذِينَ مَعَكَ وَاللَّهُ يُقَدِّرُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ عَلِمَ أَنْ لَنْ تُحْصُوهُ فَتَابَ عَلَيْكُمْ. So, this is the statement that I'm trying to make. Your nafs has agenda, an agenda to take you to the hellfire. If you do not engage your nafs with the agenda that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down to you with the messengers, your nafs is going to take you its way. It's up to you. Just for the sake of continuation, this is inshallah is going to be my theme for the next khutbahs to come whenever I deliver my speech here. But I close with this so we connect next khutbah inshallah. 4 things that you have to do. The first one I promised to talk about today, which is you must call yourself to account. Muhasabatul nafs. 2, you must tell your nafs no. No. 3, you must be patient in staying away from the haram. And you must be patient in keeping up with the halal. 4 things that you must do in order to purify your nafs, my brothers and sisters in Islam. Allahumma inna nas'aluka rabbana an tu'ati nufusana taqwaha, an tu'ati anfusana taqwaha, wa tuzakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha. Allahumma inna na'udu bika min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. Allahumma alhimna rushdana wa qina sharra anfusina ya rabbal alamin. Allahumma aslih anfusana ya akramal akramin. Allahumma aslihha wa zakkiha ya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma inna na'udu bika min alfitan ma zahara minha wa ma batan. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وأقم الصلاة.